gonna be in Psalm 121 this morning. Hope everybody's doing good this morning. Praise God. I titled this morning's message, There's Help on the Hill. And we're reading out of Psalm 121. It says, I will lift up mine eyes into the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon the right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth, and even forevermore.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Yes. You know, at its very heart, a psalm is a psalm. We've taught about that many times. As a matter of fact, in the Greek language, whenever it uses the word psalm, the word is solo, and it means a string. It's descriptive of a stringed instrument, and it's descriptive of a melody that is conducive for lyrical value to be connected to it. So basically, it's a song that's written by a singer, and the reason that it's written is because the singer has something to sing to God, amen, because it's the people of God. The greatest psalmist that we knew of was actually King David. You know, many people know his story that as a young boy, he had his harp, which was the stringed instrument, and he would play in the fields, and he learned to write these psalms unto the Lord, and it was later in his life, whenever he was going through things, that he would write these songs to the Lord, and he would let God know and praise God through the words, through the lyrics, that he would sing unto the Lord, grateful and thankful for the things that God had done in his life, whether it was protection or whether it was the help that he needed in his times of need, because many times he had enemies that were coming against him, whether it was from other nations or whether it was from King Saul himself. And so essentially the main point that I was making there is that a psalm is a song, and that these songs were written by God's people, and they were songs that thanked him and praised him, and they were used for various reasons, but commonly as a reminder to the believer of the hope that he had because of the fact that they were God's people. Amen. That God, they were God's people, and he was their God. This particular psalm is considered a pilgrim psalm. It is descriptive of the fact that the children of Israel would journey. Annually, there were the feasts. We've taught about the feasts many times out of the book of Leviticus. Very interesting concepts, things that you probably have to read and study a few times to really get the whole import of what it stands for. But real quick, in the book of Leviticus, before the children of Israel ever went into the promised land, God gave them specific feasts. He gave them the feast of, well, the Sabbath was considered a rest day, but he gave them the unleavened bread, the feast of unleavened bread, the feast of Passover, the feast of first fruits, and the feast of Pentecost. And then in the seventh month, he gave them the feast of trumpets, and then the feast of the Day of Atonement, and the feast of tabernacles. And all seven of these feasts were supposed to be observed by the children of Israel. Each and every year they were to make a journey to Jerusalem, no matter where they lived in the country. And you know, we've drawn the map many times, but essentially this would be the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan River, and the Dead Sea. And Israel, actually this would have been a little higher up here, and Israel was in this area here, but Jerusalem was way down here. So all of the people around the area of Galilee and all of the people in this terrain, and what you need to understand is too, and I'm about to talk about it in a second, that the terrain was very perilous. So it wasn't an easy journey. You know, you and I live in swampland. It's bad enough to have to put on hip boots or waders and wade through the swamp. But in rocky, mountainous terrain, it was very dangerous. For them to, you know, it's very hard traveling these distances in order to make it to Jerusalem to go to these feasts or these festivals. Now, the reason that they went to these feasts or festivals is that this is how they worshiped the Lord. This is how they showed their reverence for God and how they showed that they were devoted and dedicated to God and desiring to be in His presence, to offer up sacrifice, which for you and I is equivalent to our putting faith in Christ and what Jesus has done for us at the cross. Because ultimately, all of these things painted a picture of the fact that one day Jesus would come. So it was a pilgrim song, that psalm, that was used by travelers as they would journey towards Jerusalem to partake in these annual feasts. And once again, journeying on foot in the countryside of Israel was hard. The terrain was rocky and mountainous. And in order to get Jerusalem, along points along the way, there would be valleys and there would be hilltops. There would be ups, there would be downs. And at some points, there would be valleys, and especially whenever you got to the end there, whenever you were nearing the city of Jerusalem, there would be in a low point. Because, see, Jerusalem was a city that was set up on a hill. And so for them to, whenever the psalm is being sung and he says, I will look to the hills, it's at a time whenever they're nearing the city of Jerusalem. They're nearing their destination point. They're nearing the desire that they've been journeying for, which was to be close to the presence of God. He says, I will lift up my eyes from where my help. He says, I'm going to look to the hills from where my help comes from. And the city was, once again, it was elevated and it would have been lit up. And that has something to do, actually, with what Jesus said. If you go to Matthew 5:14 real quick. Jesus talked about a city on a hill. He talked about the fact that believers, that we were the light of the world. And he said that a city on a hill cannot be hidden. Jerusalem was a city on a hill. This is something similar. It's not exactly the same thing, but it's something similar to what Jesus was talking about regarding this psalm. Because, you see, whenever these travelers were on their way to Jerusalem and they would have been at that low point, when they saw the city up on the hill, it gave them hope. It gave them hope that they were near the presence of God. It gave them hope that they were near the destination where they could make their connection to God. And that's what they sang about, because it had been a weary travel. It had been low points and valleys and struggles and trials and turmoils. And certainly that in this real sense, it was a physical thing. But truthfully, there's a spiritual implication of valleys and low points and trials and toils and wearing us down. But there's the hope that when we make that connection to the Lord, amen, that His presence is there for us. And when Jesus said this, He was speaking to believers. He says, you're the light of the world. And a city on a hill can't be hidden. And I've spoken about this before, but whenever you were in a darkened valley and you saw the city on a hilltop, it couldn't be hidden. Mm-hmm. It was full of light. It was a beacon of light, a beacon of hope that said to the weary traveler, listen, there's hope right ahead. Amen. And Jesus wanted you and I to know as believers that the light of God was in us. And if we would allow it to emanate out of us, then it would bring hope to people that were in the midst of darkness. Amen. You need to know that there's hope even in the midst of darkness. Praise God. No matter what you're going through, no matter what you've been experiencing, what you need to know is that there's hope on the hill. Amen. There's hope on the hill. God has a plan where He desires to bring light and hope into the lives of His people. While the psalm, once again, was written describing physical valleys and hills and dangers and toils, certainly there's a spiritual implication here. The whole premise of the psalm is that the singer needs help. Whatever his circumstance may be, he finds himself in a situation where he requires help. He needs help. And that's really my main point this morning. I got one main point, and I got a couple of sub-points. But my main point this morning is that the first step in finding the help he needs lies in the fact that he must look up. He must look up. The word of God says right there, He says, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord. The enemy of God's people, I have to tell you, is a master at desiring for you not to look up. He doesn't want you to look up. He wants you to keep your eyes down. He wants you to keep your eyes focused on your circumstances and your situation. He wants you to keep your eyes focused on all of the bad things that have taken place in your life and make you feel hopeless and make you feel like you're always going to be in a darkened valley and you're never going to get out. But I'm here to tell you that when you come to the realization that you need help, if you would look up, amen, then you would begin to realize, hallelujah, where the presence of the Lord is, that there's liberty and that there's freedom. Amen. Sometimes we've been in a valley so long that we don't know anything else. Yeah. We don't know how to look anywhere else because this is all we can remember. For as long as I can remember, I've been in this valley. For as long as I can remember, I've been in the midst of this darkness. I've been in the midst of this place of where I'm lacking joy and I need strength. And I just look at my circumstances day after day and nothing seems to change. And it just, everything seems to be without hope. But I'm here to tell you that's a lie of the enemy. Amen. He wants to keep your eyes focused on your situation. But when the psalmist speaks of the hills, he speaks of the city of Jerusalem. Amen. And in the city of Jerusalem was located the house of God. And in the house of God was located the Holy of Holies. And in the Holy of Holies was located the presence of the Lord. While the singer's situation may be dark and right now he may be in a low spot, he is determined to look up. He's determined to look up because he knows that his help comes from the Lord. The main reason that he needed to look up was because he needed help. People won't look up unless they feel like they need help. Right. You know what I'm talking about? You know how human beings are. People just won't look up unless they feel like they need help. You know, the sad truth is that there will be countless millions who will never see eternity. Well, they'll see an eternity, but they'll see eternal death. They'll never see eternal life. They'll never experience the presence of God. You know why? Because they were too prideful to come to the realization that they needed help. They were going to get it done their own way. They were going to go out like Frank Sinatra. I did it my way. They were going to refuse to go the way of the Lord. And instead, they were going to stay in the midst of their darkened valley. They were going to keep their eye on their circumstances and the whole time pretend that they didn't have a situation. The first step is that you got to know that you need help. And when you need help, that's whenever you have to look up. Amen. Look to the Lord. Praise God. And if we will do that, instead, God dwells in that place and he will provide hope and he will provide rest for us. He may not always change our situation, I have to tell you that, the way we want him to.
Right.
But he will change us. Yeah. And as he does, our perception about our situation will also change.
Amen.
The truth is that sometimes our situation just doesn't change immediately.
Amen.
It doesn't change the way we want it to. Sometimes we continue to live in the midst of a situation where things around us don't change. But God will begin to change us. He'll change us, and through changing us, he'll begin to change our perception. We put our hope in him, we put our trust in him, and that no matter what else goes on around us, we keep our eyes focused on the Lord, we look up to him, knowing that he is our hope, he is our help, and he is the one that will bring it to us. Amen?
Amen.
Look up. There is Jesus. I was thinking about this particular story in the Bible out of Mark chapter 10, verse 46. In Mark chapter 10, verse 46, there's a story, 46 through 52. I can actually just read it to you real quick. It says, they came to Jericho, and as he, that's talking about Jesus, went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. But he cried the more a great deal, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. And he casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Immediately he received his sight.
Amen.
And followed Jesus in the way. Amen. Yes. He followed Jesus in the way. God opened his eyes. He looked up, and when he called upon the name of the Lord allowed his eyes to be open. He was able to see Jesus. And the Bible says from that moment moving forward, he followed Jesus in the way. What is the way? The way is the way, the truth, and the life. The hadas, the pathway that leads to God, that leads to the plan of God. Blind Bartimaeus, all of his life, looking down at his situation, looking down at his circumstance, even though he couldn't physically see, he knew exactly who he was. He was blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, and he sat by the wayside as life passed him by, struggling and begging, and all of his life depended upon the help of others that never really was able to help him. The Bible says that whenever Jesus called him, he took his garment and he threw it to the side. Now, what's interesting is that back in those days, that was a beggar's garment. That beggar's garment right there, it signified his identity. It said of who he was. This is what he was connected to. All of his life, his circumstances were the same. All of his life, his situation was the same. This is who he was. He was blind Bartimaeus, the beggar that sat on the side of the road. Couldn't get free from it. Couldn't get help from it. Sat there the whole time in desperation. But when the Lord called his name, amen, he took that old identity right there, that old garment that he previously had associated with himself, all of his circumstances, all of his past life, all of his past misery, he took that old identity, he flung it to the side, his eyes were open, he saw the Lord, and he went and he followed and he went in a new direction, amen. He followed after the Lord. The first thing you got to know is you got to know that you need help, and then you got to know where to look. Amen. Amen. Blind Bartimaeus knew that he needed help. He wasn't going to let the crowd deter him from calling on the Lord. Amen. Many times whenever we give our heart to the Lord and we begin to explain to people, whenever we take the opportunity to explain to people what God has done in our life, we're doing it for the purpose of hopefully helping them. Amen. I mean, for us to humble ourselves to the point where we say, I was at a time in my life when I needed help. And somebody told me that I needed to look up. And when I looked up, the Lord did a work in me. So here we are, we're trying to humble ourselves to give somebody access to the same hope that gave us hope, that helped us get our eyes off of our situation and circumstance and originally put them on the Lord. Amen. And here they, like the people around blind Bartimaeus, begin to ridicule. They try to keep us quiet. They don't want to hear what it is that we have to say. But listen to me. Whenever the Lord begins to move you out of your situation and your circumstance, and he puts you on the right path, and he puts you on the way to follow after him, praise God, I want to always remember that I'm a man in need of help. I don't have it figured out. I can't accomplish it in my own strength. Every time I've ever tried to do it, I only ruin it. Amen. I need help, and I know where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord. I'm going to put my eyes on the Lord. Amen. And I'm going to access his presence, and I'm going to believe God that he will show up and do what it is that I need him to do. Blind Bartimaeus is a perfect example. His whole identity was wrapped up in the fact that he couldn't see, and therefore he was reduced to begging. And once again, though, he removed that identity. He got rid of that. He took his focus off his situation and his problems. He put them on the Lord, and everything changed. Blind Bartimaeus looked up and at Jesus, because he knew that's where his help would come from. Amen. His life was changed. He said, this isn't who I am anymore. I have vision now. I will keep my eyes on Jesus instead of keeping my eyes on something that will remind me of my problems or my past. And from that day forward, he followed Jesus in the way. Amen. Amen. Four things that you should know about keeping your eyes on the Lord. Subpoint number one, as you're lifting up your eyes, as you're realizing that you need help and you're putting your eye, you're lifting up your eyes to put them on the Lord. Subpoint number one is this, is that you need to know that he made heaven and earth. Amen. It says right there, which made in verse 2 of Psalm 121. Can you put that back up there? Psalm 121, verse 2. It says, my help comes from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. The God you serve made heaven and earth. We forget sometimes this truth because our trials are really big. Our trials sometimes can get really big and overwhelming, and we easily forget how big God is. We start getting swallowed up in the midst of the trial. We start getting swallowed up in the storms of life. As the storms of life begin to, the waves begin to billow over us. That's what Jonah said whenever he ended up writing about the circumstance that happened. The billows overcame him as he was traveling down and descending into the ocean. And it was like the trial of life had just smothered him and overtaken him. And many times that's what happens to us in the midst of our situation. Our situation seems so big, we forget that God is the maker of heaven and earth. He's the creator of heaven and earth. And listen, God turned the sun back for Hezekiah. Amen. He tells waves when to stop. He tells wind when to quit blowing. He can also speak to our situation and give us hope. In Mark chapter 4, verses 39 through chapter 5, verse 9, I originally went to this passage of scripture because it spoke of that. It reminded me of the fact that Jesus has control over creation. Amen. His disciples are in a boat. You remember the story. And there arose a storm. And he was in the boat with them. And the Bible says in chapter 4, verse 39, he arose and he rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? And they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs. And no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had been bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces. Neither could any man tame him, and always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him, and cried with a loud voice, and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said unto him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. Like I said, I originally chose that passage of scripture because I remembered Jesus speaking to the wind. He's told the storm to stop. And the point that I was making earlier was that we oftentimes forget that the God we serve is the creator of heaven and earth. The psalmist said, I look to the Lord from where my help comes from, which made the heavens and the earth. His idea was that if he can create all of this, and I believe that he did, surely he can do something about my circumstance. Surely he can do something about my situation if I'll just trust him and keep my eyes on him. Amen. And so I remember that time when Jesus took authority over creation. His disciples were in a bind. They were in the boat. The storm arose. It was a physical storm, but you know, many times our life, the situations that go on in our life are like spiritual storms that take place. And the winds were contrary and the waves tossing that small boat that would have been in the Sea of Galilee, that storm that would have arisen suddenly and that they weren't prepared for. Sometimes the storms of life, we can't prepare for them. They just happen. We didn't expect it to happen. And Jesus spoke to the storm. He had authority over creation, and he spoke to the storm. And fortunately, they had Jesus in their boat. But you know, one of the things that I began to realize is this, is that as bad as the disciple storm was, it was nothing compared to this man named Legion, that they called Legion. He needed a hand. He needed some help in a bad kind of way. He needed to be able to look upon the Lord. He didn't even know how bad he needed Jesus. Amen. Because the Bible says that for years he lived in the tombs. He lived amongst the dead. He lived amongst the dead and he was bound with chains and fetters. He had the demonic possession that was on the inside of him would cause him to come to the point where he would break the chains. But I can assure you, he's probably walking around dragging these things. They're jingling the whole time. He's possessed with the devil. He's cutting on himself. We've talked about that multiple times. That's what that's all about. That cutting stuff is all demonic. It's been going on for thousands of years and it still goes on today. And he's demon possessed and he's living amongst the dead. Now he is a spiritual picture, to be perfectly honest with you, of who Matt used to be. And now I wasn't necessarily chained with physical chains, but I can assure you I was chained with spiritual chains. I was chained with spiritual chains, amen, and I was living amongst the dead. I thought that I was alive, but the reality is that I was dead. And everybody around me was dead. And the sad thing was is that the majority of us, while we were in the midst of all of that, didn't even know that we were dead. We thought that we were alive. We didn't even know that we needed help. It wasn't until I knew that I needed help that I cried out unto the Lord. This man's situation, he's so controlled by death, he's so controlled by the devil that he doesn't even realize that he needs to cry out for help. The devil's got so much control over him. He's like saying, what have I got to do with you? You know, don't destroy me. But Jesus takes authority over the situation of this man's life. And he does a creative miracle in this man's life. The Bible says that if you go back and you look at the next verse, actually in verse 15, it says Mark 5:15. It says, and they come to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil, and he had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Amen. I mean, praise the Lord. Jesus showed up and he did a creative miracle in this man's life. Whenever I began to, that's what I felt like the Lord put in my heart as I was reading this. That God, that the Lord did a creative miracle. The maker of heaven and earth that tells the wind to stop, the storms to stop, that spoke light into existence, that spoke water into existence. The maker of heaven and earth spoke a word and did a creative miracle in this man's mind, drove demons away, and there he is sitting in his right mind, and it brought me back to Psalm 51, King David, and when he wrote Psalm 51, verses 10 and 11. The story of Psalm 51 is after the sin with Bathsheba. King David has created great sin in the eyes of God. He committed adultery with another man's wife. And then in order to cover it up, he causes her husband to be placed on the front line. And he actually gives orders to the general to withdraw from him. His name was Uriah the Hittite. Now, you know, Uriah was actually known as one of the mighty men in David's army. That means that David had an army, but he had warriors that would give their life for King David. And yet, here King David sleeps with his wife, gets her pregnant, and tries to remedy the situation by bringing him home from the battlefield and having him go in unto his wife. But the man is of such noble character, he says, that's not going to happen. As long as the men are in the field fighting, I will not go in unto my wife. And he creates a situation that King David doesn't know how he's going to fix. Ultimately, he writes a letter, sends the letter with Uriah back to the battlefield to give to General Joab. And whenever he gives it to him, it reads, bring the people where the fighting is fiercest. And when the fighting gets its worst, draw back from Uriah the Hittite and let him be killed. And so that's what happened. So now what David has done is, and if you don't know the Old Testament law, what David has done, he's committed two sins that according to the Old Covenant could not be forgiven. One of them was adultery. The other one was premeditated murder. There was no sacrifice to offer up for those two sins. Those two sins required stoning by the people. David, in Psalm 51, after he has repented unto the Lord, writes this song unto God. And what he says in verse 10 and 11 is, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. King David cries out for a creative miracle. Just as Legion needed a creative miracle in his heart, King David needed a creative miracle in his heart. He calls upon the Lord. He knew where his help comes from. The one who made heaven and earth. The one who can change the inside, the interior of a man's heart. The one who can do a creative miracle, amen, and make you different today than what you were yesterday. King David cries out. God does a work in his heart. Because listen, if God doesn't do the work in your heart,
amen,
it's just going to be another time next week.
That's right.
It's going to be another time tomorrow. It's going to continue on, and it's going to continue on. And even when this situation ends, guess what? There's another one waiting for you right around the corner. We need the Lord to show up and to do a creative miracle on the inside of our heart, to renew our hearts, amen, to renew our minds. Lord, do a creative miracle in us. Praise God. He is the maker of heaven and earth. I don't want to live in bondage anymore, Lord. I don't want to live amongst the dead. Do a creation miracle in me, Lord. And that's what Jesus did for that man. As they saw him sitting there, clothed and in his right mind. Like I said, sometimes our situations seem bigger than life itself. And it appears that we will never see freedom. In this story, the disciples thought that their situation was bad. But this man had no hope. This man was so hopeless that he didn't even know that he needed help. Amen. And sometimes it's just a whisper away. I got to tell you, we got to call on the Lord. Amen. And he will show up. But what about the possessed man all his life? That's all he knew. Bound in chains, tormented by the devil in his mind, living in the tombs among the dead. He had no hope. But Jesus spoke and hope showed up. I want you to know that this is how fast God can change your circumstances if that's what he chooses to do.
Amen.
Many times I preach, well, you know, as a matter of fact, I've preached it in this message already. God may not change your circumstance, but he'll change you and he'll change your perception. But at the same time, let me make something real clear. God can change your circumstance that fast. You'll sit here living like blind Bartimaeus on the side of the road begging for years and years and years. But if you'll just hold on to God, if you'll realize that you need help and you'll look to the Lord can change your situation so fast, change your circumstances so fast that it'll make your head spin and you'll look backwards, amen, hallelujah, and you'll realize that was a God moment. God showed up. Even though I didn't think he was going to do it, even though I had almost given up hope, even though I was ready to go back to the old ways and do it the old way, the Lord showed up. He was faithful even when I wasn't faithful, and he did a work on the inside of my heart. Amen. He's the maker of heaven and earth. That's one thing that you need to remember when you look up and you put your eyes on the Lord. That's who you're looking to, the one who made heaven and earth. Subpoint number two, I want you to know this. You might slip, but you won't fall. He said right there, he said, he will not suffer your foot to be moved. He said that in Psalm 121. He will not suffer your foot to be moved. In Psalm 18 and 33, can you go to that for me real quick? King David wrote this psalm, Psalm 18:33. David said, he makes my feet like hinds' feet and sets me upon my high places. A hind is another name for a deer, or like a ram. That's the kind of feet that they have. Rams that, if you've ever seen pictures of them, that live in the Rocky Mountains. And a hind's feet, it's feet that are prepared to be stable, to stand on rocky ground. Amen. And that's what David was alluding to when he wrote about that. And that's what the Psalm in 121 speaks of, is that he's not going to allow your feet to slip. Truth be told, that sometimes slips do take place. The reality of it is that even for a ram that's made to live up in the Rocky Mountains, I can assure you there's been times that the footing has given way. But at the same time, because he is created to live in that environment, he is often able to fix and remedy the situation because his feet are on solid ground. I have to tell you that the Bible says that a righteous man falls seven times, but he gets back up. There are slips and even falls that take place in the life of believers. But whenever you have your faith in the Lord, when you hold on to the Lord, he is the one that prevents your feet from slipping to the point where you fall away. The Lord is here to preserve that which belongs to him. That's point number two under look up and see the Lord, amen, is that you need to remember he will not let you slip away. He will not let you fall away from him. If you will hold on to him and look to him, he will hold on to you, amen, and he will keep you safe. The idea here is that God is keeping watch over that which belongs to him. He will not let his own to fall. You may find yourself right now in a place in your life where you feel like you've fallen and you don't know how to get back up. I'm here to tell you to look up where your help comes from, because a slip isn't a fall. And if you will keep your eyes on the Lord and admit to him that you need help, he will steady your feet and keep you from falling. But you don't understand, preacher. I slip bad and I'm barely hanging on. I'm about to fall. Well, then you're in the perfect place.
Amen.
You're in the perfect place. Well, what do you mean? I mean, had it not been bad enough, you might not have ever come to the realization that you need help. Yeah. You might be one of those countless millions out there full of pride, refusing to admit that you need help. But if you slipped real bad and it hurt real bad and you realize that you failed the Lord real bad, then you can look to the Lord and he will not allow your feet to be moved. He will hold on to you and he will prevent you from falling away. That's what the Word of God says. Hallelujah. Jude chapter 1, verses 24 and 25 says, now unto him, Jude 1, 24 and 25. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. And to Jude is the book right before the book of Revelation. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. The Lord is able to keep you from falling. The word means, whenever classical writers used it, sure-footed as a horse that does not stumble, to cause or to make one to stand. Amen. It's the Lord that's giving stability. It's the Lord that's preventing one from falling away. Not only is he the one that can keep you from falling, he's also the one that can present you faultless. The idea there is that you're without a blemish, as the sacrifice of the Old Testament had no spot or blemish in it. The reason that he can present you faultless before the throne, but I've made so many mistakes as a Christian. What you need to understand is that you're not standing before the presence of God in your own merit. If you were, none of us would make it. Do you realize that? You know how many times people get so full of self-righteousness? All they do is they see what everybody else does and the way that they do it different than the way that they would do it, but they don't realize that your faultlessness and standing before the presence of God doesn't have anything to do with all the good that you've done. It has everything to do with the good that the Lord has done. And had you had to stand on your own merit, had I had to stand on my own merit, we'd be in a world of hurting, because we'd never be able to be. It's important that we get a revelation of that, because they got churches and Christians all around this place. Listen to me, each and every one of us in this room have done it.
Right.
Where we start looking at what we do compared to what other people do, and we think somehow that we've arrived. You hadn't arrived. Jesus arrived. Hallelujah. And thank God that he did. Because had he not showed up and revealed himself to you, you'd be standing in front of the Lord all dirty. Not faultless, but dirty. Smudged and blemished with all of the sin that you carried around. But God is good, amen, and he allowed his righteousness to be given to you as a gift. And we need to remember that. Amen. We need to remember, oh, thank you, Lord. And when we see a brother or sister caught up in a fault, or we see something in someone's life that doesn't look like it lines up with the Lord, believe me, you start digging around in my life enough, you'll see some stuff. We see some things in people's life that doesn't look the way that it's supposed to look, because we get a check in our spirit. What do you mean? Because you're saved, the Holy Spirit reveals truth to you. And sometimes you can just see something in somebody's life and you know that it's not really of the Lord. But they don't have a revelation of it. We need to pray for that person. We need to say, God, open their eyes. Open open their eyes to truth and open my eyes to truth, Lord. Yes. Don't allow me to become blinded by my own self-righteousness. Don't allow me to become blinded to where I can't even see what's going on in my own life, the failures that are in me. No, Lord, I pray that you would open the eyes of my brother and my sister. Open my eyes, Lord, that we might walk circumspectly before you, that we might live our lives in such a way that it's pleasing to you.
Amen.
The Lord is the one that's able to keep you from falling away. The Lord is the one that's able to present you faultless before his throne. Subpoint number three, he is your keeper. That's another thing that you need to remember. Whenever you're lifting up your eyes to the Lord where your help comes from, you need to remember, he is your keeper. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. You know, the word for keep there, and I think I actually mentioned this in another passage somewhere else recently, means to take care of and protect. It's the same word that was used in the book of Genesis in chapter 2 in the garden, whenever God attributed to Adam's purpose that he was to be placed in the garden to keep it. Adam was supposed to protect the garden. He was supposed to take care of the garden. Unfortunately, Adam failed. Adam failed, and he allowed the enemy in to the human race. He allowed the enemy in to wreak havoc on God's creation. This psalm speaks of the fact that the God of Israel will never sleep. He will never slumber. While men like Adam might fail and fall asleep on the job and can't be trusted. Maybe someone in your life has failed you and you've lost trust. Well, I can tell you that God won't fall asleep on the job. Amen? God is your keeper, and you and I can trust him to care for us. We may not know why he allows certain things to happen the way that he does, but you can be sure that he will complete the job. While Adam didn't keep or protect in the first garden, and the disciples fell asleep in the second garden, thank God that Jesus stayed awake.
That's right.
Amen. Jesus stayed awake. He sought the face of the Father. He cried out to the Father for the Father's will to be done. And because he endured the trial of Gethsemane and he endured the trial of Calvary, hallelujah, you and I have access to grace to strengthen us in the midst of our situation. He asked God for the strength he needed in order to fulfill the will of God. And because he did, we have access to grace.
Amen.
We have another comforter, the Holy Spirit, who is always with us. And the Holy Spirit never sleeps. He's always on guard. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Subpoint number four. He will be there in the good times and the bad. There's a passage in Psalm 121 that said, "The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night." Now, it was talking in a physical sense of the fact that dangers can take place both during the day and at night. Different kinds of dangers, right? During the day, the sun could beat hot upon the person. Dehydration could take place. Weary, you know, exhaustion take place. At nighttime, wild animals and beasts. But at the same time, there's also the idea behind the fact that Israel went along with a lunar calendar. And what does that mean? It means that the sun marked their days and the moon marked their months. And so what I need you to know is this, is that this can also describe seasons. God takes care of you even in the midst of the seasons of your life. You know, sometimes there's good seasons in your life. Sometimes there's bad seasons in your life. And you know, the Jewish people, like I said, they use this lunar calendar. And as the days go by in the life of the believer, there will be both good and bad times. Seasons of blessings. And times when you would almost think that there's a curse in your life. I don't know if you've ever experienced that as a believer, but I know that I have. Seems like that nothing goes right. Every time you turn around or turn a corner, something else bad seems to be happening. And the question, are you real God? Am I doing something wrong, God? What's going on, Lord? Well, guess what? Sometimes it is because we're doing stuff that's not right. Amen? At the same time, sometimes it's trials, tribulation, valleys, dark times that God allows for the reason why, to make you realize you need help and to make you look up, amen, from the hills where the Lord is, where your help comes from, amen. But one thing that we have to remember is that if we're really going to be found to be his people in the end, then we're going to have to serve him in both the good times and the bad. Too often when things go bad, the people of God revert back to what they knew before. They go back to what they knew before. Oh man, this isn't working. I'm going to go back to the old way. I'm going to go ahead and do what I used to do in order to numb the pain, in order to get rid of this situation, to get this deal off my back. And then too often also, whenever times are going good, people forget the Lord.
Right.
They forget where the Lord brought them. And they're like, hey, I'm doing good now. I'm just going to move on with my own agenda. Move on with my own life. And here the Lord is left. But what about me? What about me and what I did for you? In the seasons of your life, both in the good times and the bad, if we're going to be called the people of God, then we're going to serve Him until the end. Amen. Doesn't mean we're going to do everything right. Doesn't mean we're going to, always make the right decisions. But at the end, when it's all said and done, we will have served Him. We will have held on to Him. Amen. And that's how we're going to finish the race. The weary traveler looked up from the darkened valley after his long, tiresome journey, and he saw hope. He saw hope in the hills of Jerusalem because it was there that the house of God was, and it was in the house of God that His presence dwelled, and where the presence of the Lord is, there is liberty. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Just says, now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. If you go back and you read this passage of Scripture, what the Apostle Paul is actually talking about is the transitioning from the Old Covenant to the New Covenant. He talked about the Old Covenant being a covenant of condemnation. What he meant by that was that the Old Covenant was the law. And no man could keep the law. Therefore, the law accused all men and called them guilty. Yet at the same time, there was a glory connected to the old covenant because the presence of God was the glory of God that lived with the people of God. Amen? But Paul makes the point that if there was glory connected to the old covenant of condemnation, how much more is the glory connected to the new covenant? Amen? And he talked about the fact that whenever those people who were the children of Israel that Paul was actually talking about right then and there, when they read the scriptures still today, that there's a cloud, there's a veil that hangs over their eyes, makes it impossible for them to be able to see the Lord. There's an obstruction to their view. They can't see the Lord in the scriptures because there's a veil that hangs over their eyes because they refuse to move past the old and to move towards what God has done in the new covenant. Yeah. But what Paul is saying is that the Spirit of God is connected to the new covenant. And the Spirit of God opens the eyes of the believer and allows them to see the Lord. The Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Just like blind Bartimaeus, who was blind and couldn't see, when he looked upon the Lord opened his eyes and allowed him to see the glory of God and gave him hope to follow after the things of God, to follow after the way of God, amen. And in the way of God, there is freedom and there is liberty. I'm closing with this. There's help on the hill because the Savior died and there's access to His presence. Whatever you're going through this morning, I got to tell you, and I just want to encourage you to let you know that the darkest valleys, the deepest valleys, the worst of trials aren't bigger than the God you serve. Amen. He is the creator of heaven and earth and all that in them is. He speaks to storms and they obey. He's the ruler of creation. He can change us. And He can change our circumstances. And until that happens, we need to keep on holding on to the Lord. Amen. Until we see Him in glory. Praise God.